Good morning, everybody. Let me just invite Professor Wright, Pascoe Williams. In the interest of time, let me say good morning and welcome to this session, which is the Sir Alister McIntyre presentation. And we have with us this morning our distinguished awardee, Professor Rosemarie Wright Pascoe Williams, who is going to be the recipient and giving her lecture. But let me just first recognize our minister for his foresight and vision for the country, moving healthcare and expanding that healthcare to make us all a healthier nation. I want to recognize some of the distinguished scientists and physicians we have in our midst this morning. Dean Reese, University of Maryland School of Medicine. See Dr. Winter Davidson, my PhD supervisor, Professor Ellen Asimota. I see Dr. Faye Whitburn. Also with us are captains of local industries. I see my CEO of Petrojam, Mr. Floyd Grinley, the chairman of USF. We just heard all the great work that your entity is doing, Mr. Robert Lawrence. Thank you for being here. And Suzette Buchanan, who may have just stepped out, who is doing that hard work in the trenches at USF. Dr. Riley, my contemporary, we were empowered students under the tutelage of Professor Errol Morrison, Dr. Andrew Wheatley, and Professor Ellen Asimota. Maybe in some spheres, Cliff, we were extorted. But nevertheless, we are here and we are alive and we are the next generation, and we are proud to have been offered that opportunity to learn under the leadership of these stalwarts. Ladies and gentlemen, this session, let me just give you an overview of what we're going to be using our time to do. We'll have about 10 minutes clip of Sir Alister, then we'll have the citation reading of the hard work of our awardee. We'll have an award presentation of the plaque, which we'll ask Minister to join us for that photo together with Prof. Morrison, and then we'll invite Professor Williams to give her a lecture. So without further ado, let's get on.
Alister McIntyre was Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies between 1988 and 1998, exactly 10 years. Sir Alister has had a most interesting sojourn at the University of the West Indies and outside of the University of the West Indies in the wider sphere. He's also the patron of the University Diabetes Outreach Program, UDOP, and he has maintained keen interest in the work of UDOP and diabetes in general. Good morning, Sir Alister.
Good morning, and what a great pleasure to see you again.
Very nice to see you. You're looking absolutely spiffy.
Well, that's not my doing. Others in my household look after that.
Wonderful. Well, we'll talk a little bit more about that later. But I just want to go back a bit to those years. You came to the University of the West Indies in 1998, and you reminded me that it was around the time of Gilbert. Tell me what happened then.
Well, it was a traumatic experience, because certainly, although I had some notion of what bad weather was like from previous experiences in the Caribbean, my children, of course, were largely grown up in Europe, had no such experience. So it was quite a scene to get my wife and children and myself all in one bed.
Wow.
While outside the wind and the rain were raging and creating any amount of havoc. But I have to say that despite the initial shocks, we managed to survive ourselves, as indeed the country itself did. It was the country's response to Gilbert was very impressive. Concerned about the damage that has been done, trying best as possible with the resources available to deal with it, and on the whole, made a number of important advances in improving the infrastructure as a result of the recovery programs that were put in hand.
All right. Well, in terms of the University of the West Indies, Mona, what did you find yourself involved in with this sort of baptism of fire, as it were, to a new setting? It was not new for you, because you used to be in the economics department, if my memory serves me right.
That's correct, yes. I was there in calmer times, of course.
Okay.
But I joined the department in 1960. And I spent 4 years there, then moved on after a spell of a sabbatical to St. Augustine, where I was chairman of the Division of Social Sciences, and helping also to start economics at Barbados.
Wow.
So I'd leave St. Augustine at 6 o'clock in the morning, catch a 7 o'clock flight to Barbados, have a cup of tea, and go and teach until 10 o'clock, and then took a flight at 10:30 back to Trinidad, and by 11:30 I was teaching again at St. Augustine.
Awesome. I mean, really, you're...
I was young then.
You were young, and the jet set.
Well, I wouldn't say quite the jet set, because although it was very pleasurable in a way, it was very hard work.
I can imagine.
Having to do that, and then to go and face a full program of teaching and administration at St. Augustine. At the time, there were, I think, three of us in the department, and we had quite an ambitious program. So, wonderful. There you go. I was young, and I was keen, and went on with it.
Wonderful. So, coming to Mona, that was good preparation for you, for Mona, and all the excitement that came with your arriving at the time of Gilbert.
Yes.
And a lot of damage control and so on you'd have to do.
Yes.
Okay.
It was quite a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
I, of course, in the period during which I was at the United Nations, on one or two occasions, the Secretary General asked me to deal with certain developments that occurred in member states that required a special program of rehabilitation. I did one or two of those in Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Helpfully, they both came off fairly well. So I had a notion of what one needed to do faced with an emergency situation.
Disaster, like this, of that enormity.
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Now, speaking about University of the West Indies, the University Diabetes Outreach Program, you had a lot to do with it, with the creation of making it possible for it to come to pass. Professor Errol Marson, he wasn't professor then, he was
no.
Dr. Errol Marson, who had a vision for creating this entity which would teach, educate persons who were involved in providing health care under diabetes, and also lay persons who would have an interest in serving in that area. What was your role in you know, I think your role was one of facilitator in getting the UDOP started. Tell me about that.
Well, when I came, one of my desires was to get to know intimately what each staff member was doing, both in the classroom and outside of it. And Professor Morrison came to see me, and I was very impressed to find that a young lecturer in the Department of Biochemistry then, was thinking ahead of how he could arrange greater service to the community, and in particular in diabetes, which was his emerging specialty. He came to see me, and I was very impressed with his enthusiasm, his vision, and so on. So I said to him, well, the first thing you need to do, which I suppose why you're talking to me today in part, is to raise some money. Because I said you need money for equipment, you need money for to house the entity you want to set up, etc. He said, yes. So I said, well, go and write me a proposal.
Okay.
So he went and wrote the proposal, and he brought it. But I told him, I'd give it to me because I'm going to London very soon, and I'd like to have it with me. And he did so. And I went to London, and talking to colleagues and old friends and so on, I need to raise quite a bit of money for the damage, you know. And then said, but I also need to raise some money for development. So I said, what do you have in mind? I said, well, the most immediate thing I have in hand is a very interesting program to develop care for diabetes.
That was good. That was fortuitous.
And so they said, well, we'll suggest you go and see this goodly gentleman who had a foundation. And I went to see him, and he read it and said, this is very interesting. And he asked some more questions. And he said, all right, I will give you, I think he said, £500,000. So I said, well, I haven't asked you for that. I was planning to ask you for 250. He said, yes, but that is for Jamaica, but I believe you have campuses elsewhere. So I said, yes, I have in Trinidad and in Barbados. So he said, well, we are already contributing to a program in Trinidad, so I would agree to do something in Barbados. Well, that never came to pass. That's a separate thing. But I said, well, let us start with what is in existence. Dr. Morrison's ready to go. And he said, okay, I'll give him £250,000. Okay. So when I came back, I think Dr. Morrison had to hold on to his chair because he wasn't quite expecting so quick a result.
Wonderful.
But he moved into it. And within a very short period of time, he had an organization set up, he had a programs devised, and he began outreach program and concurrently planning the building.
Mm-hmm. At the Diabetes Association.
Diabetes building, where it is now.
Palmer Avenue, yes.
That's
it was
correct.
An extension, that's the operationalization of the UDOP idea.
That's correct. And he had a group of very enthusiastic people, Jamaicans, supporting it. And I was over the top to think that we could start the program because I had an interest in it, if I may put it that way, being a diabetic myself. Mm-hmm. And nothing gave me greater pleasure than to see the speed with which that building was put up and an active program started. No amount of praise is too much for Professor Morrison in the energy and dedication that he applied to get that that program active.
Facilitator, without those type of persons, Professor Morrison, ideas can just fall by the wayside. And we need somebody like a Sir Alister to go and find the necessary funds to get things going and to help facilitate this vision. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to read the citation of one such person who has dedicated her life, her time, her expertise to making Jamaicans, in particular Jamaicans affected by this disease, diabetes, to live a better quality of life and a more active life. So, Dr. Wright, Pascoe, I would like you to stand beside me, and Dr. Williams in the audience, no pressure. Professor Rosemarie Wright Pascoe Williams, MBBS, DM, FACP, FACE, FRCP, UK. The Sir Alister McIntyre Distinguished Awardee, 2018. Professor Wright Pascoe Williams is a graduate of the University of West Indies and the University of Edinburgh. On returning to Jamaica, she joined the Department of Medicine at the University of the West Indies Hospital of the West Indies in the Department of Medicine as a consultant physician and has served the university with distinction over 3 decades, playing a critical role in teaching and research. Professor Rosemarie Wright Pascoe Williams's research interests have included the etiology, pathophysiology, classification and complications of diabetes mellitus and Gray's disease. Her current research interest is in the pathophysiology of type 1 diabetes mellitus, glycemic control in diabetes mellitus, and the diagnosis of diabetes through evaluation of oral health. She was instrumental in the study of maturity onset of diabetes of the young in the Jamaican population between 2000 and 2003, the efficacy of the newly approved drug acarbose in Jamaican diabetics between 1995 and 2000, and the first description of visceral obesity in Jamaican diabetics. She has authored 2 book chapters and more than 80 scientific papers and abstracts, which have been published in high-impact peer-reviewed journals, amongst others. She has been a peer reviewer for the journals Journal of National Diabetes Association, the West Indian Medical Journal, the Journal of the Royal College of Physicians, Clinical Audit, International Journal of General Medicine, International Journal of Nephrology and Renal Vascular Disease, and Diabetes, Metabolic Syndrome and Obesity Targets and Therapy. She is a member of the Board of International Advisory Network of the Journal of the Royal College of Physicians, an internal medicine journal published in Scotland by the Royal College of Physicians in Edinburgh. For more than 15 years, she has been an assistant voluntary professor of the University of Miami for the William J. Harrington Medical Training Program for Latin America and the Caribbean, which offers training in medicine research to medical students, physicians, and university faculty staff of persons working within the Caribbean and Latin America. She has been named to several national working groups in the field of diabetes and endocrinology and metabolism. She was the first chairman of the National Committee for Non-Communicable Diseases in Jamaica between 2011 and 2013, a CARICOM ratified committee whose role is to help in the reduction of the prevalence, morbidity, mortality of persons affected by these non-communicable diseases. Professor Wright Pascoe Williams has provided leadership in the profession of medicine, having been a president of the Medical Association of Jamaica between 07 and 09, and the Association of Consultant Physicians of Jamaica during the period 2011-2013. She was one of the founding fathers and first president of the Caribbean Endocrine Society in 2008-2010. In recognition of her outstanding role in medicine, endocrinology, and metabolism, Dr. Wright Pascoe Williams has been elevated to Fellow of several colleges, the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh, the American College of Physicians, and the American College of Endocrinology. Professor Wright Pascoe has been appointed the head of the Department of Medicine of the University of West Indies, Mona, and holds the unique distinction of being the first female head of this department. Ladies and gentlemen, the University Diabetes Outreach Program is therefore pleased and honored to bestow the Sir Alister McIntyre Distinguished Award 2018 on Professor Rosemarie Wright Pascoe Williams for outstanding and distinguished service in the field of endocrinology and medical education. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause. And for that outstanding body of work, there is a beautiful plaque made in honor of the advocacy of Sir Alister back after Gilbert, 1998, Rosemarie. Professor, we invite you to give your lecture.
Thank you. I really want to thank the organizers and especially Professor Morrison for giving me this Sir Alister McIntyre Distinguished Lecture. Professor Morrison has been my mentor for many years. Firstly, he was one of those who taught us biochemistry in the MBBS program. And secondly, when I was doing my Doctor of Medicine, Internal Medicine, he was my supervisor for my clinical research project, which was on diabetes, on diabetic neuropathy. And he encouraged my specialization in the field of diabetology and endocrinology. And over the years, he's continued to mentor me. And in fact, I believe that I have been to these conferences every year for the last 20 plus years, and I've perhaps missed one or two of the conferences. So it really is a pleasure and an honor for me to be here to be given this award. It must be noted that there have been many other Sir Alister McIntyre Distinguished Lecturers, and I follow a long line of persons who have achieved in academia and in research and in lecture and in tutoring. And so I feel extremely humbled to be, in fact, given this award. I joined the University of the West Indies in the period when Sir Alister McIntyre was the Vice Chancellor of the University. And the University of the West Indies at this time is having its 70th anniversary celebration. And I just want to note that Sir Alister McIntyre is a quintessential Caribbean man who had a passion for the economical growth of the Caribbean. And I feel that he has contributed, and the university has, to my growth and development as an academic person, as a tutor, and as a researcher. And I am really deeply, have a lot of gratitude to offer to the University of the West Indies for the person who I am today. So I want to thank Professor Morrison and thank all the organizers of the UDOP 2018 for inviting me to speak today on the particular topic which I'm going to speak on. Excuse me. They're supposed to be. Can I get that cursor, please? And I'm going to talk about the tale of diabetes in the Caribbean, the untold story. Now, diabetes is a Greek word which means siphon. And that really speaks to the osmotic diuresis that occurs and the polyuria that occurs in these persons. And mellitus is a Latin word which means honeyed or sweet and speaks to the glycosuria that occurs. But diabetes mellitus has been known for many, many years, in fact. We're talking about Aretaeus. He was an Egyptian medical practitioner who practiced medicine the year 120 AD, and he asserted that short will be the life of the man in whom the disease is fully developed. And I invite you to see if at the end of this presentation his assertions were correct or were incorrect. It's a very important disorder, as you've heard, in the Caribbean. We have a prevalence of approximately 9%, a low prevalence of 8.7% here in Suriname, a high prevalence of 16.4% in Barbados, with Antigua and St. Kitts around 12 to 13%, Jamaica and the Cayman Islands around 14%. But not only is the prevalence high, but the prevalence differs amongst the different races. It's highest in Indo-Caribbeans, second highest in blacks, third highest in the mixed races, and fourth in Caucasians. Now, although we are ranked in Latin America and the Caribbean, diabetes is very, very common in the Caribbean, more so than in Mexico, for instance, in the United States of America, where the prevalence is some 9.3%. And the prevalence of diabetes in Jamaica has been increasing over the years, regardless of the population being studied, the criteria that is used to make the diagnosis. And so you've seen the prevalence increase from 1.3% to a high of 17.9%. And some 10 years ago, we noted that the prevalence was 7.9% for diabetes and 2.8% for impaired fasting glucose. Now, the International Diabetes Federation asserted that in 2013, there were 27 million persons with diabetes in North America and the Caribbean, and they feel that by 2035, there'll be 50 million persons. And this increase in the number of persons with diabetes will occur in all categories, all places of the world. And what we're talking about here is type 2 diabetes, and that will be the essence of my presentation today. So in Trinidad and Tobago, it's expected that there'll be a doubling of the number of persons with diabetes, and that there'll be a doubling of that in the number of persons with diabetes in Barbados. Bahamas will have more than a tenfold increase in the persons with diabetes. And in Jamaica, you're expected to have a threefold increase in the number of persons with diabetes. Some 189,000 will be expected by the year 2030. But if you look at the 2009 data coming from the Ministry of Health, we have already exceeded that. We have approximately 210,000 persons with diabetes in Jamaica. Now, this is a diabetes epidemic. There is a diabetes epidemic. And this diabetes epidemic is affecting the developing countries. And I invite you to look here and to see that the developing country increase will be predominantly in the age group 65 years and older. But if you look at the developing countries, it will predominantly occur in the age group 45 to 64 years. And I think that you all agree with me that this is when an individual is most productive in his contribution to his family, his economy, and economy of his community and of his country. And we already saw that. In 2000, we noted that most of the persons who had diabetes and who were attending the DHA's clinic were between the ages of 40 to 69. Now, this is an important disorder because diabetes is the second leading cause of death in the Caribbean and Jamaica, with 72 per 100,000 deaths in Carrick and 70 per 100,000 deaths in Jamaica. It is in Jamaica in 2007, 2009, it was the third leading cause of death in our Jamaican men and the first leading cause of death in Jamaican women. So this is an important disorder. A Trinidad and Tobago's Guardian newspaper had a rather dramatic headline calling diabetes in Trinidad and Tobago ranked the number two killer in that country. Now, what is driving the epidemic of diabetes is overweight and obesity. And what we're looking at here is a percentage of overweight and obese adults with a BMI greater than 25 in the year 1980 and the year 2008. And you can see that in that 20-year period, the prevalence or the percentage of overweight and obese adults has doubled in Latin America. And this is also seen in the Caribbean, because you can see that the overweight obesity has been increasing sequentially in both males and females. So in Jamaica, we had 38.3% of our men who were overweight and obese, and 64.4% of our women who were overweight and obese. Now, the World Health Organization decided to rank the highest female overweight obesity in the world. And I invite you to guess who was ranked number 8, who was ranked number 10, who was ranked number 11 and who was ranked number 13 and 14. We have any guesses from the audience? Okay. So we have Barbados, number 8. That is in the world. Trinidad and Tobago, number 10. Dominica, number 60%, number 11. The USA, and we all think the USA has more obesity than the Caribbean. It's not so, as you can see here. 60%. And in Jamaica, 53%. And it's the first time that we are willing for you to, for the United States and all other Caribbean countries, to outrank us. Go for that. We're very happy with that. We're quite happy with that. And who are we going for? We're going for rank number 1 with Nora at 83% overweight obesity in the world. And Tonga at 81% overweight obesity in the world in their female population. Now, we had already seen this overweight obesity in our diabetes patients because we found that 50% of them were overweight and some 27% of them were obese, giving you a 70 to 80% overweight obesity. And driving the overweight obesity and the diabetes epidemic is also physical inactivity. So we can see that in 2000, 17.4% of Jamaicans were physically inactive. And in 2008, that was 29.5%. And our concerns, of course, as physicians, is that there's a global burden that type 2 diabetes confers on the world, not only in the number of sheer numbers of persons with diabetes, but the sheer percentage of persons who have diabetes and are unaware of it, but also in the health costs. 12% of global health cost is towards diabetes, outranking all other disorders. And we have a concern about that. There's an economic cost of diabetes in terms of the reduced labor force, the reduced labor input because of absenteeism, for instance, the lower tax revenue, the lower returns on human capital investments, the increased public health and social welfare expenditure, and the cost to the employer, the reduced productivity in persons with diabetes, and the increased shelling out of health benefits to manage those persons who have diabetes. But there are also costs to the health system. Increased consumption of diabetes-related health care and high medical costs per episode. The demand for more effective treatment, and you've heard our minister speak about the need to increase technology to access treatment and care for those persons with non-communicable diseases. And what we have here is a dialysis unit, and more we're needing more and more dialysis units across the Caribbean. What we have here is a cardiac catheterization unit, and as we speak, the University Hospital of the West Indies is building a new cardiac catheterization unit, again to address the needs of our people. There's also the fact that health system adaptation needs and costs are necessary, rather consistent with what our minister said. This requires organization, it requires service delivery, and it requires financing. But what about the individual? You've heard that 1/3 of the household salaries income goes to the cost of diabetes. There's reduced well-being. There's increased disabilities. There's premature deaths. The diabetic loses approximately 10 years of their lifespan. The household income may be decreased or lost or may be impoverished, may occur. So here is an individual who has a diabetic foot, started out with a cellulitis, rapidly accelerates to gangrene. This individual is going to be in hospital for at least 25 days. And of course, this disability will have an impact on his ability to contribute to his household income. So these higher health expenditures can be quite catastrophic. And then there are lost savings and assets. And so I had one of my patients who told me that he had $750,000 in the bank and it's gone because of diabetes spending. There is also reduced opportunities that may arise. Now, diabetes in Jamaica and the rest of the Caribbean consumes a lot of the public health usage. So here we have approximately 30,000 numbers of visits to our public health centers for diabetes in Jamaica, and that was up to 2012. And if you look at Trinidad and Tobago, and again, these are 2004 figures, the direct cost was around $38 million US dollars. The indirect costs around $246 million, with a total cost of $300 million. Hospitalizations are consumed by persons with diabetes. Here, Port of Spain, 13.6% of hospitalization is because of diabetes. 23% of hospital bed occupancy for diabetes-related diseases, and this is predominantly hyperglycemia and foot problems. And these accounted for 52% of the hospital bed occupancy amongst diabetes. In 2002, diabetes cost the Jamaican economy $33 million. The annual cost to the Barbadian economy per person, $577. And in the Bahamas, $16,000 or $17,000. Not only is it a costly event, a disease that causes increased mortality, not only is it a long-standing condition that is not curable, but it's also associated with serious complications of diabetic retinopathy, nephropathy, diabetic neuropathy, stroke, and cardiovascular disease. And this is what we call the disease burden of diabetes, a leading cause of blindness, two-thirds leading cause of end-stage renal disease here in the Caribbean, a leading cause of non-traumatic amputations, and a twofold increased risk of stroke, and a 2 to 4-fold increased risk of cardiovascular disease. And diabetes is responsible for 25% of cardiac surgeries, with a mortality that is predominantly due to cardiovascular disease. So in Trinidad and Tobago, for instance, diabetes is the second leading cause of blindness. And the prevalence of diabetic retinopathy, which precedes blindness, is a whopping 28.5% in Barbados. Now, if we look to the United States, diabetes is the most common cause of end-stage renal disease. And we have quite a number of persons who have end-stage renal disease and who are able to get dialysis. 211 in Bahamas, 185 in Barbados, 27 British Virgin Islands, 41 in the Cayman Islands, 366 in Jamaica, and 436 in Tobago. But these are 2007 figures. And by the time we reached 2011, Trinidad now had 699 patients on dialysis treatment. And what they found was that more than 50% of all cases of stage 5 chronic kidney disease in Trinidad was due to diabetes or hypertension. This is a disorder that is also responsible for lower extremity amputation. And these are figures coming from Barbados. In their non-diabetic population, 173 per 1 million population had experienced lower extremity amputation. But in the diabetic population, this was ninefold or eightfold, with 936 per 1 million population. Let me just tell you what the figures are for a developed country, such as Madrid, Spain. That is 2.8 per 1 million population, and this is their incidence for low extremity amputation in diabetics. So nobody is going to be surprised when Barbados is called the amputation capital of the world. Now, stroke causes more disability than any other disease. Stroke patients, more so than heart failure, diabetes, or arthritis. And when we look at stroke deaths in Jamaica, and this was published in Stroke in 2009, we found that this was 18% of total deaths. We look at the age-adjusted death rate, this was 115 per 100,000 of the population. And Jamaica has the unenviable ranking of number 63 in the world for stroke deaths. This is something that we have to address, because 70% of patients who had a stroke had diabetes or hypertension or both. Now, this is a very important concept, the fact that diabetes patients are 2 to 4-fold higher risk of cardiovascular disease. On the y-axis, we're looking at the incidence of fatal or non-fatal myocardial infarction, and here it is 7 years later. This is a diabetic with myocardial infarction. They have the highest incidence. This is a non-diabetic who's had a myocardial infarction. This is a diabetic who's not had a myocardial infarction. This is a non-diabetic who's not had a myocardial infarction. And as you can see, the diabetic who's not had a previous myocardial infarction, risk for a fatal or non-fatal myocardial infarction 7 years later, is exactly the same as the individual who's non-diabetic and who has had a myocardial infarction. And therefore, you're not going to be surprised that we say that diabetes is a walking heart attack waiting to happen. So when we looked at cardiovascular disease and diabetes in Trinidad, they found that the risk of 10-year coronary heart disease risk was highest in the diabetic population. When they looked at their patients who had had an acute myocardial infarction, 13.5% of their patients had diabetes, and 43.2% had both diabetes and hypertension. When we looked at heart failure in Antigua in 1995 and 1996, of 293 patients, 38% of them had diabetes. Now, this is a study that was published in West India Medical Journal in 2007, looking at who are the patients who undergo coronary artery bypass graft. And they found that diabetes was present in 72% of these patients. So, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I think that we agree it is a catastrophic disorder with catastrophic consequences, including economic consequences. But there are things that we can do. And so we know that good diabetes care is crucial to delay the complications of diabetes. Good glycemic control will result in a reduction of the complications and will result in better patient outcomes. And we know from the United Kingdom Prospective Diabetes Study that for every 1% reduction in hemoglobin A1C, you will reduce the relative risk of the complications of stroke by 12%, peripheral vascular disease by 43%, microvascular disease by 37%, and cataract extraction by 19%. Armed with that knowledge, we know that for every 1% reduction in hemoglobin A1C, we'll reduce the diabetes-related endpoint by 21%, death by 21%, all-cause mortality and myocardial infarction by 14%. And armed with this information, we go out into the world as physicians and as healthcare workers to get our patients to target. We also know that if we can detect diabetes early, we will save lives and reduce complications. So I'm going to use the Managing Diabetes in Primary Care in the Caribbean 2006 protocol as the protocol that we will use as we try to manage our patients. So for screening for diabetes, they say, don't use a population-based approach. Only screen persons with identifiable risk factors. And you know them all. The overweight individual, the older persons over the age of 45, the person who's physically inactive, the person who has a first-degree relative with diabetes, who has had previous gestational diabetes, or who has polycystic ovary syndrome. You know them. If you've had pre-diabetes before, you should be screened. If you have dyslipidemia with a low HDL and a high triglyceride level, if you are of the race of Asian or African descent, which speaks therefore to almost all persons in the Caribbean, you should be screened. And if you have vascular disease, coronary artery disease, hypertension, or vascular complications. I just want to tell you that not only will we have one of the most innovative things when what Minister mentioned comes on stream, but the Jamaica has one of the most innovative thing with the National Health Fund, where we offer a subsidized hemoglobin A1C test for all persons enrolled in the National Health Fund who have hypertension, coronary artery disease, or hyperlipidemia. And this National Health Fund has been around since 2003, and it is there to improve the affordability of healthcare for the Jamaican population and to improve the effectiveness and to offer subsidy to access medication in both the public as well as the private health sector. And in 2008, they had enrolled some 65,000 persons with diabetes, 1,100,000 with hypertension, 50,000 with high cholesterol, and approximately 30,000 with vascular disease. Coming back to our protocol, they say that the management of diabetes is a multidisciplinary one, but the composition of the team will depend on the country's resources. A medical doctor, a nurse practitioner, a nurse, a diabetes educator, a nutritionist, dietitian, a podiatrist, a pharmacist, a social worker, that you should be able to access care with an endocrinologist or diabetes specialist, physiotherapist, psychologist, ophthalmologist, and nephrologist. But I want to focus today on diabetes educator and nutritionist dietitian, because diabetes educators are the one that deal with diabetes self-management education. And this is the process by which we facilitate the knowledge, the skill, and the ability necessary for diabetes self-care. And this is one in which the goals, the needs, and life experiences of that particular person is utilized in designing a diabetes self-management education for that particular patient in front of you. And the objectives are to support decision-making, self-care behaviors, problem-solving, active collaboration with the healthcare team, improving, therefore, clinical outcomes, improving health status, and improving quality of life. Well, what is the evidence that this works? We know that there's improvement of knowledge and education. There is improvement in problem solving and anxiety levels. There's an increase in the physical activity. There's an improvement in the intake of carbohydrate, fat, calories, and you've heard Minister talk about lower glycemic index foods. Although, Minister, we had hoped you would give us examples so that when we went out for the coffee break, we would know what to avoid. But I'll talk with you afterwards, all right? So we know it increases the frequency of the use of self-monitoring of blood glucose, and it results in weight loss. It also results in an improvement in glycated hemoglobin, an improvement in cholesterol, LDL, total cholesterol, and HDL cholesterol. And very importantly, a decrease in emergency room visits for hyperglycemia and hypoglycemia, a decrease in serious foot lesions at 1 year, and a reduction in foot ulcer and amputation rate. And this is a meta-analysis which was published in 2004, which demonstrate that in 2,000 plus patients with diabetes patient education, you have a drop in hemoglobin A1C of 1.14%. So does diabetes education work in the Caribbean? And this is an example from Trinidad and Tobago, where they had an intervention group that was offered intensive diabetes education versus the other group where we say to them, do that and do this, and we hand out brochures. And what they found was that, yes, there was a reduction in hemoglobin A1C levels that were from 9.2% to 7.4%. And that was statistically significant. So it works in the Caribbean. What I want to ask you is, how seriously do you think we, as Caribbean people, view diabetes education? And I can wait for the answer. Is in your own practices, do you see this as an important entity? Do you see a structured approach to diabetes education in the Caribbean? Well, why don't we look at the diabetes educators' posts in government facilities? There are none. Why don't we look at the University Hospital of the West Indies, which is supposed to be the specialty tertiary referral center for the Caribbean? There's none. What we have are one or two trained diabetes educators who in their own spare time volunteer their services to offer education to persons in the hospital. In Jamaica, we have some diabetes educators in private practice who are paid for by the pharmaceutical companies who offer these services. But the most important thing is that there's no reimbursement for diabetes care by the health insurance industry. And I am sure you're aware that that was supposed to be over here. So I have to speak to these guys when I'm finished. Thank you very much. Okay. So what do our people feel about diabetes care? Please note that 71% of patients indicated that they needed more education about diabetes, but they wanted their diabetes education to come from the physician, and the physician doesn't have the time to do this. And so diabetes educators really are essential members of the team, and we should have more of them. Because diabetes awareness and management, these are the major challenges faced by stakeholders worldwide. Poor knowledge related to diabetes is reported in many studies from the developing countries. And there are barriers to lifestyle changes and glycemic control that we have documented, a low education level, inadequate knowledge of diabetes, a lack of perceived risk. They are unaware of the consequences of their behavior. and lack of self-monitoring, and these can be addressed by diabetes education. Let's talk a little bit about carbohydrate intake. You heard ministers say that the American Diabetes Association had said that you should eat simple sugars and avoid complex carbohydrates. But we now know that carbohydrate intake has a significant effect on postprandial glucose, and that this is the macronutrient that we have to work with and focus on for glycemic management. So what does our protocol say? There's a generalized red meat, reduce that, eat fish, white meat and legumes, eat complex carbohydrates, high fiber foods, avoid your refined sugars, restrict your salt and your sodium, high sodium foods, eat your fresh vegetables and your fresh fruits, and so on and so forth. And these are the generic advice that we give to all our patients. And they say, refer to a nutritionist dietitian when available. And I emphasize that, where available. And they say, especially so for the new patients or the patient with dietary indiscretion. But I think that we are well aware that all our patients have dietary indiscretion. Now, this is a study that we did, which demonstrated that those individuals who receive nutritional counseling were more likely than those not receiving counseling to not drink soft drinks, were more likely not to consume fast foods, were more likely not to drink alcohol. In fact, they were more knowledgeable about their diabetes, and they had a much more positive outlook as to what it would take on their part and the part of their clinicians to manage the disease effectively. So when we looked at patients attending the diabetes clinic at the University Hospital of the West Indies, only 23% of them were controlled to a hemoglobin A1C of less than 6.5%. 85% had been seen by a dietitian, because we do have a dietitian in our clinic. But only 56.4% reported being on a special diet. And in fact, a whopping is that 80% reported taking sugars in their diet. And this is also so in Trinidad. 70% of them are non-compliant with the diet as women, and 80% or so of the men were also non-compliant with diet. But how seriously do we view nutritional counseling to persons with diabetes in the Caribbean? What do you all see in your practices? What do you see being practiced? Well, I just went to the Caribbean Association of Nutritionists and Dietitians website, and I found that there are only 100 of them. There are 80 dietitians and 70 who are English-speaking nutritionists, and they're serving the Caribbean population of 7.25 million persons. I think it's clear that we do not consider this category of healthcare workers important enough to train them and employ them in a system. I'm going back to the protocol, and we say to persons, regular aerobic exercise, sustained for 30 to 60 minutes at least 5 times a week. And we give this advice to all of our patients. And we know it works. We know that it reduces hemoglobin A1C, that it will reduce systolic blood pressure. I want to draw your attention to a particular study which I found fascinating, done in Italy. Now, in 606 patients, they did twice a week supervised aerobic and resistance training. They also offered a structured exercise counseling versus the usual counseling, which is go and exercise 30 to 50, 60 minutes, 5 times per week. And this is what they found. Naturally, there was an improvement in physical fitness, and as expected, a reduction in the hemoglobin A1C levels, the systolic diastolic blood pressure, and the lipid profile, and in the waist circumference. But I want to draw your attention to this. A reduction in insulin resistance, well known to be a risk factor for cardiovascular disease, a reduction in inflammation, and the risk scores for cardiovascular disease. Now, Trinidad is a little bit more expressive than other newspapers, Express newspaper, called the diabetics, delinquent diabetics, because the patients there said sitting was their primary leisure activity 85% of the times. I just love this. It's really very nice. Okay. So we know that the majority of patients with diabetes will not control glycemia with just diet and exercise and will require pharmacotherapy. And the pharmacotherapy suggested that you use this after you've tried diet and exercise for 4 to 6 weeks. Use combination of classes and use low-dose combination therapy early so as to improve the efficacy of the therapy and minimize side effects. We have all of these in the Caribbean, excepting for this one and this one. So we have a wide variety of drugs to choose from. We have all of these insulins in the Caribbean, and we have GLP-1 receptor analogs, but we don't have amylin analogs. So we have a wide variety of drugs to choose from. And in Jamaica, our patients get a subsidy of 60%, which costs the Jamaican population $26 million Jamaican dollars. So that patients pay on average around $4,000 for their diabetes drugs. And we're not the only one. In Trinidad, they have a chronic disease assistance program where they give free prescription drugs and other pharmaceutical items. Barbados has a drug benefit service, which is for those persons aged 65 years and older who have chronic diseases. So we know that we could prescribe anything that we want to. But if for them to be effective, adherence to the prescribed regimen is important. But adherence, as we all know, is an issue amongst our patients. In Trinidad and Tobago, 50% of the times the patients fail to take their medication. And we had already documented in Jamaica that non-compliance with medication it affected adversely the hemoglobin A1C levels. And so we are left with diabetics who are non-compliant with diet and exercise, poorly educated, not taking the medication that we prescribe to them, and we're thinking, my God, the Caribbean patient is such an awful patient. But that's not true. The World Health Organization has shown that adherence to long-term therapy for chronic diseases in developed countries averages only 50%. There are inherent problems with prescribing drugs for chronic non-communicable diseases. Some of the factors associated with that include polypharmacy. And the UK prospective diabetes study had already informed us that most diabetics are on 10 drugs or more because they're hyperglycemic, hypertensive, hyperlipidemic, and they have arthritis, etc., etc. The complexity of the medication regimes. You take some before meals, some after meals, some three times a day, some at bedtime, will reduce adherence. No Caribbean person worth his tenure is going to take injectable medications. They resist it. They don't like it. Associated adverse events, weight gain. I had a patient who had done expensive surgery on her abdomen. She'd now had her tummy tuck, and she was hyperglycemic, and she said, don't give me anything that's going to cause me to gain weight. I'm not going to take it. And that, of course, is an issue. You can't use drugs that's going to cause weight gain, cardiovascular problems, or hypoglycemia. So the suggestions are reduce the treatment complexity of your regimes. Use fixed-dose combinations. They're antihypertensive agents where you have three drugs in one tablet. And we have oral hypoglycemic agents where you have two drugs in one tablet. Decrease the frequency of administration from twice a day to once a day is ideal, and avoid use medications that are weight neutral. You may use those that are weight reducing. But I tell you, I did that in one of my patients, and she came back and said, I've lost my bottom. I want back my drugs. I changed the medication and gave her back the medication that caused her to gain weight, and I see her and she's dimpled all over, but she likes it and her husband likes it. Please remember, you've got to consider these things for your patients, right? And try and avoid glucose drugs that cause hypoglycemia. Then if the patients perceive the drug is not safe, how many of you have tried prescribing HMG coenzyme A inhibitors, your antilipid drugs? Every patient tells you about liver disease. And they all take the prescription, smile at you. And when they come back, you say, did you take it? No, I didn't buy it. Okay, so you must reduce that perception that the drug that you're giving to them, in fact, is safe. There's no point prescribing drugs that they can't afford, and you must have a good patient healthcare provider relationship with them. So what you've got to do is you have to educate your patient, increase their knowledge, ensure that the benefits of the drug outweigh the cost, and improve continuity of care, which means that every time they come to the public clinic, they see the same physician all the time. And of course, we've just heard about increase communication through websites and electronic records. They like to come and know that you know all about them because you have access to their records. So treatment of diabetes is pretty exhausting because you have to treat the hyperglycemia, the diet, the weight, exercise, the weight loss, treat the hypertension, the hyperlipidemia, not let them smoke, reduce alcohol intake, use, prevent thrombosis, and of course, screen for chronic complications. So this study is a very important study, the Stena trial, where they targeted hyperglycemia, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and microalbuminuria all at the same time. And they showed that it slowed the progression to nephropathy, retinopathy, and autonomic neuropathy. Not much effect on cardiovascular complications, however. So Wills et al. Had a look at this study, looking at a specialty public medical clinic, a private medical clinic, a public medical clinic. And my criticism of this study was that it was a retrospective study. So they said that how many patients had had their blood glucoses looked at in the clinic? And that was 84%, in the private clinic 79%, and in the public medical clinic 67%. What was the percentage of patients who had had hemoglobin A1C measured? It was low, 16% here, 10% here, 0% there. But the problem is that glycosylated hemoglobin had just been introduced to Jamaica, was an expensive test, was not well understood. saith the Lord. Because that is a rich country, and they're having problems, just as we are having problems. So it's nice to know. So perhaps what we should be doing is offering surgery to all our patients. All right, this is 6,587 patients who have had bariatric surgery. A Roux-en-Y gastric bypass up here, adjustable, adjustable gastric band down here, and they experience a BMI reduction of 5, type 2 diabetes reduction of 33%, hypertension reduction of 27%, and we're talking about surgical cure here, and surgical cure for hyperlipidemia of 20%. So perhaps we should be offering this surgery to all our patients. Be very mindful, however, that the adverse events are as high as 23%. So maybe that's not it. So my final portion of this presentation is just to tell you that bariatric surgeries here in the Caribbean, Trinidad and Tobago, Jamaica, Barbados, Bahamas, almost all Caribbean countries have bariatric surgery. So let's look at the experience that they have had. 218 patients, 172 got the Roux-en-Y gastric bypass, 15 got sleeve gastrectomy, 9 gastric banding. The average weight loss, pretty impressive, 23 kilograms to 127 kilograms. And 28% of them had diabetes. Cure rate, 85% cure rate for diabetes. The remaining 9 patients achieved excellent control with decreased medications. But I think that that is not the way forward. Let us talk about foot care. In Trinidad and Tobago, or where they had patients who had had diabetes before, had been hospitalized before, had ischemic heart disease, renal impairment, retinopathy, not well controlled. But despite this, they continued their unhealthy lifestyles. And despite this, they continued not to be taught about foot care by the medical practitioners and other healthcare workers. So I want to talk about Guyana, where 48% of their patients have existing diabetic foot ulcers or were at high risk for developing ulcers. And they did something about it. And this is the Guyana Diabetes and Foot Care Project, a complex quality improvement intervention to decrease diabetes-related major lower extremity amputations and improve diabetes care in a lower middle-income country. Consider that as the title of a journal article. It is much too wordy. Anyway, moving along. Right. So this is Georgetown Public Hospital, and they noted that it was the commonest cause of admission to the surgical ward. And in the end, 42% of the patients lost a lower extremity. So they assessed it, and they noted and started to do interactive, interprofessional, 3-day best practice sessions with the clinicians. They taught them about wound bed preparation. They noted that the physicians were working in silos. Healthcare professionals over here doing their own thing, over there doing their own thing, no coordinated effort. They noted and continued to teach them how to comprehensively assess the foot in the clinic, how to manage diabetes, dyslipidemia, and hypertension, They noticed that there was no comprehensive assessment process for persons admitted with diabetic foot, and they addressed that. They noticed the nurses were demoralized, the heavy burden, and the feeling that they could not initiate change. They designed preceptors to model interprofessional communication collaboration, and they provided practice aids and patient assessment tools. They had on-the-job training and mentorship. Medical officers were initially resistant to participate, but they brought them in, and they noted that the patients presented late for treatment and they had a poor level of diabetes knowledge. The men were reluctant to come in for diabetes screening, although they were the ones who were being admitted for foot complications. And they noticed very poor footwear, the open rubber dinkies, as they call it, or flip-flops, with the strap between the first and second toe, which apparently was the preferred footwear for Guyanese men. Didn't know that, learned something. They noticed the absence of plantar redistribution modalities, no special shoes, no orthotics, no other plantar pressure redistribution devices. They noticed the absence of healthcare human resources, no podiatrist, no endocrinologist, no vascular surgeon available. They noticed the lack of equipment and resources, no Dopplers, no skin thermometers, no plantar pressure redistribution therapy, no A1C testing in the public health system, no home blood glucose monitoring, and of course, frequent interruptions in the supply chain. You have metformin today, tomorrow you don't have it. You have dressings today, tomorrow you don't have it. They notice the lack of funding at the level of the Ministry of Health. The Ministry of Health being heavily dependent on foreign contributions to support health care, and that most of the health care expenditures was coming from external resources, and it was mostly designated for HIV care. And those of us in diabetes criticize this enormously because HIV apparently is now the poster child, and diabetes, the diabetic patient apparently is now Cinderella, who's not to be offered anything. So they designed a Guyana-based 60-second screening tool for the high-risk diabetic foot. They created new diabetic foot centers, new referral mechanisms, whereby you'd be referred to a center for surveillance, foot care, footwear education, plantar pressure redistribution. They had key interventions. They developed interprofessional key opinion leader team. All were sent to do a 9-month course at the University of Toronto, providing advanced education in how to care for chronic wounds. All did a diabetes educator course, and they found an outpatient diabetic foot center. They changed the systems, networking with the key stakeholders of the Ministry of Health and the hospital. They started community awareness through television, using the Ministry of Health programs, and they designed patient information handouts and as an adjunct to care. So before, what they had was a mean monthly number of amputations of 7.95 per month. After that intervention, it fell to 3.89, a 68% reduction in the average rate of major amputations. Ladies and gentlemen and colleagues, we have presented what appears to be a dismal story for the management of diabetes in the Caribbean. The increasing numbers of persons with diabetes, the increasing predisposing factors for diabetes, the high rate of non-education and non-adherence to therapy, and the high rate of complications of diabetes in the Caribbean. But I think that the study that I just presented shows you the way forward, that diabetes care in the Caribbean requires a holistic approach. You've got to develop your human resources and you've got to engage them in the process. You need substantial system level improvements, and your delivery system needs fixing, and the information capabilities need to be improved. I want to thank you so much for your attention. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause for Professor Rosemarie Wright Pascoe Williams. Let me just open the floor for a few questions, comments, suggestions. Anybody? There's a microphone in the center. If you could tell us your name, your institution.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Patience Bazwaye Alonge from Northern Caribbean University. Thank you, Professor Williams, for that excellent presentation. While you were presenting, my mind kept running off. How do we prevent? The bottom line is education. So at what level, at what stage? Who should be the educators? Will it be just the physicians? Or everybody, stakeholders, parents, teachers from the primary school, high school, university. So we need to think and make policy for diabetic educators. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Patience.
thank you very much for those comments. I didn't spend a lot of time looking at prevention of diabetes, but prevention of diabetes is going to require a holistic approach, as you've said. The government has to be involved in preventing this epidemic from getting worse, and all stakeholders, meaning everybody in the Caribbean countries, will have to be involved. It will involve not only just education at the level of primary school, high school, university, not only change in physical activity and a reduction and an understanding of how overweight, obesity affects diabetes, but it involves the built environment. How do you change the environment so that people feel free and easy to exercise, and how accessible will exercise be? How will you change the labeling of foods and how foods are manufactured? So it involves a holistic approach, and in fact, it's another 1 hour presentation, which I didn't have time to do. But thank you so much for your comments.
Thank you. Any more questions?
Thank you, Ms. Chairman. Thank you. Excellent presentation.
Thank you.
My question is, over the next 25 years, what plan do you have to improve the number of physicians as diabetologists to lead to see how it can contribute to your diabetes problem? Thank you.
Excellent point. Excellent point. And what Dr. Raju has asked is, how will we improve the number of diabetes specialists in the Caribbean? Is that a good summary of what you've said?
Absolutely.
You know, I am in the business of education. The Department of Medicine at the University of the West Indies has a Doctor of Medicine program in internal medicine. And our internal medicine physicians, our graduates, now populate all the hospitals in Jamaica. The program is also in Trinidad and Tobago. It's also in the Bahamas and in Barbados. And they are very well grounded on the management of diabetes. So they form the nucleus, and they should be disseminated to all hospitals and all clinics. They are the ones who should, in fact, be providing care for persons who have chronic non-communicable diseases, including diabetes. But we are very much aware that it's the primary healthcare physician who 90% of the times is managing diabetes, and they are the ones who require education. And so this kind of forum, the University Diabetes Outreach Program, is one such way of teaching and training persons. But I think we need another more holistic approach. So in the MBBS program, for instance, we do a lot of teaching on diabetes management. I hope that will be helpful.
Can I ask one more
follow-up?
One more comment on the, in terms of primary prevention of people who do not have diabetes, for example, who are at risk with obesity or family history positive, etc. A, breast milk for the baby. Those who give 1 year breastfeeding seem to have less diabetes. And B, say for example, World Health Organization recently agreed that those who are at high risk can be given metformin even though they don't have diabetes. Can you comment on those things?
So you're saying that the breastfed individual who's been breastfed for more than a year has a reduced risk of diabetes. That is a new finding that has been disseminated, and clearly a policy would have to be made whether we're going to encourage breastfeeding beyond 6 months, because right now we encourage breastfeeding for up to 6 months, and beyond afterwards is your own decision. Again, it's always through education. And the second question you've asked is whether we should be prescribing metformin to prevent diabetes in those persons who have pre-diabetes.
Or those who are at high risk of developing diabetes.
Yes, high risk of developing diabetes.
WHO has agreed and approved already.
Yes. You know, there is an issue there. The issue, of course, is the cost of medication and the cost benefit. And at this point in time, there is not any one professional organization that has suggested that everybody should be on metformin. The suggestion is you try a diet, lifestyle changes, follow up the patient, and if that individual does not achieve the target that you want them to do, then you may consider using metformin. I think physicians will have to make individual decisions based on the patient in front of them, rather than wait for a universal policy to be made.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
One more question.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much, Professor Williams. I'm a third year biochemistry major at NCU.
I'm sorry, you're a third year?
Third year biochemistry major.
Biochemistry.
Well, so far, I've been, you know, learning a lot. However, in summary, what I'm seeing, based on my understanding thus far, is that the human body, as we would understand, is like an automobile. It's like a vehicle. And what makes a good mechanic is the fact that he knows, you know, everything about his vehicle. And I think, in my view, that's where the issue is. Individuals do not know the system. They don't know the body, right? And with the knowledge that I have now, the biochemical processes, the metabolism, I mean, how the organs function, what they need to do, and how they do it more effectively. I mean, you mentioned a holistic approach. I'm thinking along the lines of, how do you eat? When do you eat? What kind of activities do you do? How do you prevent these issues from taking place in the first place? Right? I mean, the pancreas is the organ that really prevents all these issues. But if you continuously feed the system in the wrong way, continuously prevent the system from being effective by clogging it. I mean, for example, when you have a vehicle, if you don't maintain it, then it gets clogged, oil, you know, that type of issue.
Yes.
So right now, I mean, I'm a very physically active person, and I want to mention this. I haven't taken any form of medication for over maybe 12 years now. I had a toothache and I decided I will stop. I won't take any medication. From then, I just didn't. Mm-hmm. But I'm not bashing the pharmaceuticals now. It has its place. But I think the issue really is individuals not knowing what they are, essentially. So if we're able, as was rightly mentioned earlier, education is very important. And I think everyone has that responsibility to learn as much as they can about their system, their body, in order to effectively live.
I think it's an excellent point. And we have, you might have noticed that in Jamaica, there's some National Health Fund ads that have been running about the unhealthy lifestyle, such as not exercising, in having too many sugars in your diet, and so on. But you're correct, again, a more holistic approach would be to start teaching our babies in school, just as how we have sex education that start at X time. We have the same education about the importance of food, weight, and diet, and food choices straight through as high school, straight through into university, the importance of physical activity, etc., and the consequences of diabetes and the other non-chronic communicable diseases. So education is key, I think, and it should be at all stages of the life cycle. Thank you.
One comment, and then go ahead.
I'm a diabetes educator and a pharmacist. For the past 5 years, I've been doing a diabetes education clinic. I live in Grand Cayman. And what is very interesting is that many, many, many patients, the HbA1c has dropped significantly. In fact, the last person that I worked with, they were admitted to critical care with HbA1c of 17. And with a multidisciplinary approach where the doctor referred that patient to my diabetes education clinic that I do once a week, actually, because I'm a pharmacist as well. And between February and July, the HbA1c fell to 6.4%. What I'm saying is that education is so very, very key. Many patients that come to my clinic, they don't know what to eat. They don't know how to care their feet. They don't know so many things. They don't know, not even to the correct timing of the medication with respect to meals. So what I want to say, it was an experiment that was actually started 5 years ago. It was a six-month experiment where the GP doctors referred patients that had HbA1c that was over 8% to my clinic. And then because it became more successful, the internists started to refer patients to surgeons and so forth. So I think one of the key is a multidisciplinary approach in diabetes management, where persons are trained as diabetes educators, where they are pharmacists, nurses, nutritionists, and that they are a part of a system of referral, so that it is a multidisciplinary approach. Absolutely. I think that is the most effective management of diabetes.
Thank you very much for sharing. Ladies and gentlemen, we have heard the expert suggestions and recommendations. Increasing diabetes educators, simplified nutritional advice, foot care. Those are some of the key things that can bring about a healthier society. But I also want to add one thing, Professor Williams, is that there is a pilot study being done at Petrojam, and I have to give kudos to the management and staff at Petrojam, together with the vision of our nurse who heads the health department, and she's sitting just behind Professor Morrison. Nurse brought the idea that how can we educate and make our highly skilled workforce more healthier, and what she has been spearheading over the past year with a partnership with Diabetes Association of Jamaica is to give that workplace advice, following, tracking, keeping our staff healthy. And that may be one of the key messages to private sector industry, to government agencies, to foster diabetes education, reaching out to the experts to come in and to share that body of knowledge instead of going to the hospitals. So they're first in class, they're doing excellent work, and please continue to forge that. And I'm just proud to be serving as a director of the board and chairman of Petrojam, who is also a sponsor for this session. So Dr. Wright Pascoe Williams, thank you very much for sharing, and we now adjourn for coffee break.